And now what we're going to do, how many of you are familiar with Ephesians 5, 25 through 27? You'll see it on your notes, where it says, "Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church, gave himself for it, that he might sanctify it and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word, that he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having a spot or a wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish." Okay, everyone's familiar with that verse. Okay, what is a spot? What is a wrinkle? What is a blemish? If we know that we're supposed to be a set apart, which is what sanctified means, what holy means, to be set apart, and we're not supposed to have any spots, wrinkles, or blemish, that's the goal. Well, how can we, as a future bride, let's say, get ourselves rid of our spots, wrinkles, and blemishes when they don't know what they are? Does that make sense? Do you know, in the Torah, it mentions 12 specific blemishes that the priest couldn't have, otherwise he couldn't minister. So why not go to Torah to find out what the 12 blemishes are? There are 3 specific spots that are mentioned. See, your answer, see, the New Testament wants to take you back to the Torah so you can find the answers. So that's what we're going to look at today. What does it mean to have a spot, a wrinkle, or a blemish, and how in the world do you get rid of them? Because that's what the Lord wants to do. He wants to sanctify us and cleanse us. So when the Bible talks about spots, wrinkles, and blemishes, do you think it's talking about how we need to get rid of our literal wrinkles or spot remover, you know, with some kaboom spot remover or something like that, or wrinkle remover? No, it's not talking about physical spots, wrinkles, and blemishes, or we're all in trouble. Okay, so we're going to look at what it may mean. Well, one thing we do know from Exodus chapter 19, verse 6, God had said to Israel, he wants them to be a kingdom of priests. They were to be a holy nation. These are the words which you shall speak to the children of Israel. Well, I want you to relate, they were to be holy. And Ephesians 5 says the body of Messiah is to be what? Holy. Okay, so we're going to go through the Torah and find out, as a priest, what spots, blemishes, wrinkles they shouldn't have, so then we know what the parallel is. In Leviticus 22, verse 21, here's what it says. "Whoever offers a sacrifice of peace offerings to the Lord to accomplish his vow, or a freewill offering in beeves or sheep, it shall be perfect to be accepted. There shall be no blemish therein." Right? So here it's talking about the sacrifice. The animal that they offered, if you remember in Malachi, God was all upset because they were offering the blind, the lame, you know, the scraps. And he remember that verse, and he says, "Would you offer this to your governor or to your king? Is he going to receive it?" And so we see the sacrifice itself also had to be without spot, wrinkle, or blemish, right? And a lot of the reason why that is because they represent Messiah, and he was without spot, wrinkle, or blemish. Here we see in Malachi 1:8, "Are you going to offer the blind for sacrifice? Is that not evil? And if you offer the lame and the sick, is that not evil? Offer it now to your governor. Will he be pleased with you or accept your person, says the Lord of hosts?" In other words, I don't think so. Now look at Romans 12:1. He says, "I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice that is what? Holy, acceptable unto God, which is a reasonable service." So that means we are the sacrificial offering that are laying on the altar. We're laying our lives on the altar to God. But this says we're supposed to be set apart, and it has to be acceptable to God. Now, I was talking to someone just a little bit earlier before the service. Most Christians don't understand the entire sacrificial offering. They're only saying what they've been taught, and they've been taught wrong. Do you know there was no sacrifice for intentional sin? There wasn't any. Most of these sacrifices were just thanksgiving offerings or peace offerings or what's called the olah offering, which is the burnt offering, where the entire sacrifice was completely consumed. Can you imagine, I mean, I don't know how much a bull costs today, but let's say you have an adult bull. I mean, that's going to be probably a couple $1,000s or something like that. Well, the peace offering was shared. The peace offering was an offering that the person who offered it got a part of the peace offering. The priest got a part of it, and the Lord got part of it. But the olah offering, nobody got any of it but God. The priest didn't get any of it. The person who offered didn't get any of it. It all went to God. So when they're offering a bull as a burnt offering, it's just like someone felt, Lord, I want to do something for you. It's called, in Hebrew, it's called korban, to draw close. It's a gift. And so here you have someone says, I want to draw close to you, God. I want to draw near. And so they would offer a bull, but that's like you taking a $1,000 bill and lighting it on fire and letting it go up to God. Look at the concept of what they were doing. They were literally spending hard-earned money, and they were just offering the whole thing up to God. Okay, well, Romans 12:1 is the olah offering. It's not necessarily the peace offering. Okay, there were several offerings. It's not the asham or the guilt offering. This is the olah offering. In other words, what he is saying to us, we are to present our entire bodies, the whole enchilada, so to speak, okay? Too often, we only want to give God part of our lives. That's not acceptable. He wants the entire, he wants every bit of us, okay? And so, and when we present ourselves, I mean, God is the one who makes us holy. We don't make us holy. It's something else I want you to point, to realize. We don't, which is another important point I'll go ahead and bring out here, taking some side notes. But let me mention something to you. If, let's say you have your grandma's dishes that are antiques, okay? Do you use them every day or do you set them apart? So those dishes are holy. All holiness means, it's important to realize this, holy does not mean righteous. Holy does not mean righteous. Prostitutes were called holy. They were set apart for a work. Okay, all holy means is set apart. It doesn't mean righteous whatsoever. Okay, so here, when you take grandma's dishes and set them apart, they're holy, right? But are they holy to you or holy to me? They're holy to you. Nothing personal, but I don't care about your grandma's dishes. Okay, so when you set something apart, it's holy to you. Now, when God sets something apart, it's holy to him, okay? And then he asks us, like when he sets us apart, he's saying, now we're holy, but see, he is the only one that can make us holy. If we set ourselves apart, well, that's great for you, but it doesn't do nothing for God. So all too often, mankind tries to make themselves holy, and it doesn't work that way. Only God can set you apart, okay? And then then that's another point. Now comes sanctification, let me explain it to you this way. Let's look at this. When God makes the Sabbath holy, he what? He set it apart, so it's holy to God. Now man can set a day apart, but it's holy to him. Okay, and so we just something to be thinking about. But let's look at this. These are the 12 different blemishes, and they all come from Leviticus 21, verse 16 through 22. And look at what it says here on your notes. It says that the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, speak unto Aaron, saying, whoever he be of your seed in their generations that has any blemish, let him not approach to offer the bread of his God. Now, we just saw that the sacrifice itself couldn't have any blemishes. Now we're going to see the priest who offered it also couldn't have a blemish. And so let's look at what they are. It says, whatsoever man he be that has a blemish, he shall not approach. And you're going to notice it's almost identical to the animals. Okay? The priest, if he was blind, he couldn't offer. If he was lame, if he had a flat nose, if he had anything superfluous, or a man that is broken-footed or broken-handed, or a hunched back, or a dwarf, or that has a blemish in his eye, or have scurvy, or is scabbed, or has his stones broken, no man that has a blemish of the seed of Aaron the priest shall come nigh to offer the offerings of the Lord made by fire. He has a blemish. But here's the good news. It says, but he shall not come nigh to offer the bread of his God, but he shall eat the bread of his God. So he's not cut out of fellowship. He can have fellowship with God. You following me? He just can't do the work of the priesthood. But he still can eat the bread and everything. And if I want you to notice, some of this is a good thing. How many of you, when you're injured, want to continue working? If you've got a bad back, do you want to have your boss force you to work or let you have a layoff or something? If you're blind, how would you like to be a blind priest working around fire? How would you like to have a broken hand and have to pick up the sheep? So in one sense, I want you to see this is a good thing. God is not being hard. He's being graceful. Because if you got a broken foot, how would you like to be the one to have to walk? But there's a balance in all of this. God is amazing. He still doesn't want you to have these blemishes. He wants you to get healed. You following me? So I don't want you to see this as a judgmental thing. I want you to see God is merciful, but he wants to have his church, his body, be without blemish. So he's saying, get healed, guys. And until you get healed, I'm not going to allow you to do the work. How often do you find some people, they want to be involved in the ministry, but they got some problems, and you got to set them aside until they get healed before they can come back and do the ministry? Well, that's what this is all about. So it's not. Don't see this as a judgmental, condemning thing. It's a matter of God saying, look, you've got a blemish. Let's get this thing healed, and then you can come back again. You following me? So that's how I want you to receive this teaching, and we're going to look at these things. Now, what's amazing to me is how many blemishes there are within the body of Messiah. Okay, first off, how many of you, talk about, hey, we're priests? Okay, well, if you think you're a priest, or if you're part of the church, guess what? You better work on these blemishes. You better get these things resolved if you want to do that. Do you want to sit on the sidelines and watch, or do you want to be involved in the work? Well, let's look at blind. Let's look at this first blemish. In 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 3 through 4, it says, if our gospel is hid, it is hid to them that are lost, in whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which don't believe, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine to them. In Matthew 23:24, it talks about you blind guides which strain at a gnat and swallow a camel. So here we see that our minds can be blinded, can't they? But now let's look at this. Here he's speaking to a church with blind eyes. In Revelation 3, we see there's a blindness in the church. He's speaking to the Laodicean church here, and it says, because you say, I am rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing, but you don't realize you're wretched, you're miserable, you're poor, you are blind and naked. So he says, I counsel you to buy me gold that is tried in the fire, that you may be rich, white raiment that you may be clothed, and that the shame of your nakedness does not appear, and anoint your eye with eye salves that you may see. I can't help but think of that story growing up as a kid about the king who had no clothes or something, and he thought he looked great, and everyone realized, well, that's the Laodicean church, okay? They think they can see, but they don't. Now, what are some of the things that can cause blindness? Look at 1 John 2, verse 9 through 11. He that says he's in the light and he hates his brother is in darkness even till now. He that loves his brother abides in the light, and there's no occasion of stumbling in him. But he that hates his brother is in darkness and walks in darkness and knows not where he goes, because the darkness has blinded his eyes. So one of the things that brings spiritual blindness is hating one another and hating our brother, or hating whole groups of people. Okay, racism or whatever. These are the kind of things that is going to produce spiritual blindness. Now look at 2 Peter. I thought this was fascinating. Chapter 1, verse 5 through 9. It says, and beside this, give all diligence, add to your faith virtue, to your virtue knowledge, to knowledge temperance, to your temperance patience, to patience godliness, to godliness brotherly kindness, to brotherly kindness love or charity. For if these things be in you and abound, they make you that you will neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But whoever lacks these things is what? So right there is telling you. And he can't see afar off, and he's forgotten that he was purged from his old sins. And so this, what I'm going to start doing is connecting some dots so you can see what he was talking about. You have first the natural, then the spiritual, okay? So God takes the natural blemishes that he mentions in the priesthood, and we're going to look and see what the application is for us today. So God is saying, look, if you think you want to be a minister of the gospel, you need to make sure that you have these characteristics or you're going to be blind leading the blind. Now, how about lame? Okay, well, what does that mean? What does it spiritually mean to be lame? Well, if you look at Proverbs 26:7, it says the legs of the lame are what? They're not equal. And then it says, and so is a parable in the mouth of fools. In Hebraism vernacular, what they often do is they say the same thing twice. Okay, but in a different way, so you could get another idea what they're talking about. Well, here, what it's talking about is unequal measures. Just like people, they will say one thing, but they do another. And look at Ezekiel 18, verse 25. Well, let me start with verse 23. It says, have I any pleasure at all that the wicked should die, says the Lord God? And not that he should return from his ways and live, but when the righteous turns away from his righteousness and commits iniquity and does according to all the abominations that the wicked man does, shall he live? All of his righteousness that he has done shall not even be mentioned. In his trespass that he's trespassed, and in his sin that he sinned, in them shall he die. Yet you say, why, the way of the Lord is not equal. Hear now, O house of Israel, is not my way equal, and not your ways unequal? In other words, they're saying here, God is saying, boy, if a person's righteous his whole life and then he turns from me and he does all this wicked and abominable things, I'm not going to remember any of those things he did for those 50 years. But if a person is wicked, totally wicked for 50 years and then he repents and for that next year or two he does everything righteous, he says, I'm not going to remember any of his wickedness. And they're saying, that's not fair. You're not fair. And God says, wait a minute. Who are you to say my ways are unequal? It's your ways that are unequal. If you look at Proverbs 20, verse 10, it says, diverse weights, diverse measures, both of them are like an abomination to the Lord. In other words, you have one measurement for someone and another measurement for someone else. It's like the money changers. You know what the deal was with the money changers when they overturned it in the temple? I don't know how many of you have been to Israel, but when I went to the Temple Mount, there's called the exchange rate. And you want to know how much the dollar converts into a shekel. And roughly, it's like a shekel's a quarter. It's like 4 shekels to the dollar. But one of the times when we were there, some people didn't have time to go to the money changers, the legitimate ones. And there was an Arab man at the Temple Mount, you know, saying, you know, I'll exchange your dollars for shekels here. But he was ripping them off a horrible exchange rate. Okay, and the people weren't aware of it because they couldn't do the math, the percentage, and all the numbers. And we caught him and said, stop. You know, we had like 30 or 40 people. Quit exchanging your money with this guy. And he got all upset at us and everything. But we knew he was ripping everybody off. Well, the money changers, if you remember, they would not allow a foreign god's image into the temple, right? They weren't supposed to. Everyone's coins had foreign gods on them. So they had to exchange them before into the Jewish coins or whatever before they could go in and buy whatever sacrifices. There was a Gentile court, and the Gentiles would go in with their foreign currency. They'd want to buy sacrifices and things. And they were ripping the Gentiles off. The money changers were, you know, totally extorting everything. And so that's what upset the Lord. They had unequal measures. And so one of the blemishes we find, you ever heard the term, that's a lame excuse? Okay, I mean, see, there's different ways of looking at the vernacular. So what God is saying, you have unequal ways. You're doing one way for you. How many of us oftentimes will have one standard for us, but another standard for everyone else? Everyone, I want you to understand, I'm only human, but I'm not going to think you are. Okay, now, here's this next one, and this has to be one of my favorite. A flat nose. A flat nose. Can you imagine what it means to have a flat nose? When you think about a flat nose, well, one of the things that's fascinating is if you look at the Song of Solomon, chapter 7, verse 4, Here it says, your neck is as a tower of ivory, your eyes like the fish pools in Heshbon by the gate of Bath-Rabban. Your nose is as the tower of Lebanon. Now, how many of you ladies would like to have someone come up to you and say, your nose is like the tower of Lebanon? Are you going to take that as a compliment? Well, I'll smack you, boy. My nose ain't like a tower. And yet, think about it. Here, the groom is speaking to the bride saying, your nose is like this tower of Lebanon. So that seems to be a good thing, you would hope. But the bad thing is if you have a flat nose. So what's the difference between a flat nose and a big nose? Well, if you look at the word in Hebrew for the flat nose, it means to be set apart, especially for destruction, to be blunt as the nose. It also can be translated to be accursed. Well, here we see in Song of Solomon 7:4, someone who had a nose like the Tower of Lebanon. But I want you to notice this. Let's look at Hebrews 5:14. It says, strong meat belongs to them that are of full age, even those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. So you notice discernment is tied to the senses. Okay, let's look at Hebrews 4:12-13. It says, the word of God is quick, it's powerful, it's sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and of the joints and marrow. And the word of God, we see, is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Neither is there any creature that is not manifest in his sight, but all things are naked and open to the eyes of him with whom we have to do. So we see the word of God is what? It's a discerner. Look at 1 Corinthians 2:14. The natural man receives not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him. Neither can he even know them, because they are spiritually discerned. You ever heard the term, I smell a rat? How about something smells fishy in Denmark? Having a flat nose means this priest has no spiritual discernment. Having a nose like a Tower of Lebanon means she has great spiritual discernment. If you'll notice in the Song of Solomon, she's looking toward Damascus. That's where the enemy is. That's Syria. It's like a watchtower. Okay? So if you want to consider yourself a watchman, you need to be looking in the direction of where the enemy could be coming, and you need to have great spiritual discernment. Do you know, remember the verse in Hebrews talking about the Spirit of God as a discerner? Look what it says in Job. In Job 27:1-3. Moreover, Job continued this parable and he said, as God lives, who has taken away my judgment, and the Almighty who has vexed my soul, all the while my breath is in me, and the Spirit of God is in my nostrils. So where's the Spirit of God, he says? And the Spirit is the discerner. Okay? Now, if you remember, it also means to be set apart for destruction. Kerem, that's what the flat nose meant. We'll look at 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 9, 10, and 12. It says, the Lord knows how to deliver the godly out of temptations and to reserve the unjust to the day of judgment to be punished, but chiefly them that walk after the flesh in the lust of uncleanness. They despise government, but these as natural brute beasts are made to be taken and destroyed. That's exactly what the word kerem means, to be taken and destroyed, to be set apart, to be judged. They speak evil of the things they don't understand. They shall utterly perish in their own corruption and shall receive the reward of unrighteousness as they count it to pleasure to write in the daytime. And then what does it say? Spots they are and... You see how this ties right into what we're talking about today, spots and blemishes. Having a flat nose is people who are walking after the flesh. They have no spiritual discernment. That's what that is talking about. Okay, now let's look at the next one. Anything superfluous. Okay, here's a picture of someone who has something superfluous. He happens to have an extra finger. Okay, the word superfluous means to be deformed by excess of members or to stretch out self. So what I believe the Bible is saying here, in Isaiah 28:20, it says, for the bed is shorter than that a man can stretch himself on it, and the covering narrower than that he can wrap himself in it. What the superfluous means you're stretching out self. You're trying to add self to what God says. Let me add a little bit of my opinion to what God has to say. We see in 1 Chronicles 20, Goliath, his brother, he had, it says, 24 hands or 24 fingers and toes. He had 6 fingers on each hand, 6 toes on each foot instead of 5. So he had a total of 24 digits. I mean, this guy basically is a man of the flesh. You see what I'm saying in the spiritual parallel here? But what do we find in Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 2? You shall not add to the word which I command you, neither shall you diminish from it, that you may keep the commandments of the Lord your God, which I command you. Okay? So we're not supposed to be adding to God's commands. We're not supposed to be diminishing from God's commands. But here, having anything superfluous, I believe, is the priest who is adding to the word of God, which is what they were accused of. Many of the priests, they mishandled the word of God. In Proverbs 30, verse 5 through 6, it says, every word of God is pure. He is a shield to them that put their trust in him. Don't you add to his words, lest he reprove you and you be found a liar. Okay, in Revelation, where it mentions that, everything that's in the, I tell you what, I have a list. I didn't bring it with me, but I have a list of the entire New Testament, verse by verse, showing everywhere it corresponds to a verse in the Old Testament. The whole New Testament is just quoting the Old Testament in another way. You know, there's over 200 verses in Revelation, or there's over 200 verses of the Old Testament that are repeated in the book of Revelation. So how can you understand Revelation if you don't know the over 200 verses that they're referring to in the Old Testament? The next blemish is a broken foot. Well, I'll tell you what, if you've got a broken foot, that affects your walk, that affects your ability to stand. In Isaiah 65, verse 1 and 2, it says that the Lord says, I'm sought of them that have not even asked for me. I am found of them that weren't looking for me. I said, behold me, unto a nation that was not called by my name. I spread out my hands all the day to a rebellious people, which walk in a way that was not good, which is after their own thoughts. So here, what God is saying, if you are walking in your own way, you're walking after your own thoughts, you're not fit to be a minister for the gospel. We need to quit walking after our own thoughts. Jeremiah 10:23. O Lord, I know that the way of man is not in himself. It's not in a man that walks to direct his steps. It's not in us. We need direction. I mean, it's like you're in the ocean without a compass. We need to realize, in one sense, we were born with a broken compass, and we need God to fix our compass. Okay? And we need to walk not after our own thoughts, but after his thoughts and his ways. In Jeremiah 13, verse 10 and 16, this evil people which refuse to hear my words. So what makes them evil? They refuse to hear God's words. They walk in the imagination of their heart. They walk after other gods to serve them and to worship them shall even be as this girdle which is good for nothing. Give glory to the Lord your God before he caused darkness and before your feet stumble upon the dark mountains. While you look for light, he turns it to the shadow of death and he makes it gross darkness. In Proverbs 25:19, it says, confidence in an unfaithful man in a time of trouble is like a broken tooth or a foot out of joint. So it's telling you, putting confidence in unfaithful people in a time of trouble is like having a broken foot. Proverbs 4:26 and 27, ponder the path of your feet, let all your ways be established, turn not to the right hand or to the left, remove your foot from evil. 2 Corinthians 4:2, it talks about people who have renounced the hidden things of dishonesty, not walking in craftiness. Okay? So a broken foot, symbolically, what's that speaking of is your walk. How are you walking? I think it's amazing when you read things that happen to people in the Bible. Let's look at Numbers 22:25. Matter of fact, it's this weekend's Torah portion, this story about Balaam. Remember Balaam? Remember God didn't like the way he was walking? So what happens? When the ass saw the angel of the Lord, she thrust herself into the wall and crushed Balaam's foot against the wall. So God crushed Balaam's foot against the wall to give him a clue. Your walk is not right, buddy. You following me? Now, something I'm going to add here, because I won't be here this weekend to teach you this Torah portion, but I think it's very important. And maybe I'm answering a question you've never asked, but I'll put the question out there. Maybe you have thought of it. Do you remember God had told Balaam not to go with them, right? And then it says, Balaam had them come back, talk to him some more. And so God says, okay, fine, you can go with them. Remember that? But then it says Balaam went with them and God was angry that he went with them. After he said he could go. You ever wondered why? How come God said you could go with him and then it says he goes with them and then God was angry that he went with them? The answer is in the Hebrew word, with. You keep singing the English with, but in the Hebrew there's different Hebrew words for the word with. And so you don't know what the difference is. So here's the difference. Let's say you're in a car, or let's say you're hitchhiking. Okay? And a car pulls up and they volunteer to give you a ride. So you jump in the car and you're going down the road and all of a sudden the guy says, oh, I got to get some gas. He goes into the gas station. You're waiting in the car. He comes back out and they take off. Well, unbeknownst to you, he just got done robbing the grocery store or the gas station. Now you're taking off. The police come, woo, and they stop and they surround it and they go to arrest you. And they say, well, you were with him. Yeah, but I was with him, but I wasn't with him. You following me? You were with him, but you weren't with him. Well, you see that in the Hebrew. You don't see it in the English. When God said you could go with them, he said you could accompany them. But Balaam, where it says he went with them, it means with the intent to curse. He didn't go just to accompany. God, who knows the heart, saw that he was with them in wanting to curse Israel. And so he was angry at him, not because he accompanied them, but because he was going with the intent to curse. Okay? So that's the difference. That's why it's good to understand this. Now, we have a broken hand. Well, what do you think? If a broken foot is your walk, what do you think a broken hand is? Your works. Okay, remember we had read it earlier about God says, in all your works, you deny him. I mean, here, Cain was doing religious works, but God rejected him. Matter of fact, in some of the Gospels, the Lord says, you're workers of iniquity, for heaven's sake. Okay, so let's take a look at this. A broken hand, that talks about your works or your ability to handle the word of God. 2 Corinthians 4:2. It says, but you have renounced the hidden things of dishonesty, not walking in craftiness. That was your broken foot. Now we have nor handling the word of God deceitfully. So if you have a broken hand, that means you are mishandling the word of God. Here in 2 Timothy 2:15, it talks about study to show yourself approved to God, a workman that needs not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Okay, so if you're rightly dividing the word of truth, you don't have a broken hand. If you take a look here at Jeremiah chapter 2 and verse 8, the priests never even said, where is the Lord? Now, if you think about this for a minute, if you're an intermediary, the purpose of a priest is to bring man and God together, right? You're in the middle. And here he's saying the priests, they're not even asking, where is God? Now, how many of you remember the verse, I stand at the door, knock, and if any man open, you know. How often have you heard that for an evangelistic verse, to trying to get the saved unsaved, as if God is knocking on their door? That's completely unbiblical. Do you know what it's saying? He's speaking to the church and telling them to open the door. And they don't even know God's outside. Here the Lord's knocking at the Laodicean door and they're going, leave us alone, we're having church. They're not even asking, where is the Lord? That's the same thing this is talking about. The priests, the people who are supposed to be God's people, aren't even asking, where is he? And then it says, and they that are handling the Torah don't even know me. So you have a lot of people, and that's why there's so much misunderstanding about law and Torah, because a lot of times the rabbis who are handling it aren't teaching it correctly. They are mishandling it, just like they were back then. But you don't throw out the Torah. You need to find someone who knows how to rightly divide it, and so it can give the right definition to it. But here he's saying those people, the priests that are handling the Torah, they don't even know me. The pastors also have transgressed against me, and the prophets prophesied by Baal, and they walked after things that don't profit. Now in Matthew 7, 21 and 22, it says, not everyone that says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but he that does the will of my Father which is in heaven. Many are going to say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, we've not prophesied in your name, and your name cast out devils, and in your name done many wonderful works. So here you have a lot of people, they seem to be filled with the Spirit. I mean, they're casting out devils, they're prophesying. But God says, I don't even know you. In Luke 13, verse 26 and 27, it says, then you're going to begin to say, we've eaten and we've drunk in your presence. You've taught in our streets. In other words, I've gone to church. I've been in your presence. I've heard your word spoken. But he's going to say, I tell you, I don't even know where you've come from. Depart from me, all you workers of iniquity. They think what they're doing is all these wonderful works. He's saying not. Okay? And here's one of the reasons why. Here, just give you another quick example. I don't know how many of you ever owned a business, but it's the same thing if you're an employee. But let's give the example if you're working at McDonald's, okay? And the guy wants you to run the cash register. Okay? And that's, you only have so many positions, all right? But let's say you really like landscaping. And so for some reason, the boss comes, and there are all these people lined up at the register, and you're out pulling weeds. It's like, hello, I need you over here. This is your place in the body. This is what you need to be doing. Oh, yeah, but I don't like registers. Okay, a lot of people are doing all these wonderful works, but they're not doing what God told them to do. What we need to do is find out what God wants us to do and do that, not do what we want to do. Okay? I mean, just think about it with your own kids. You give them jobs, you want them to do it, but they go do something else. Well, that's great, but that's not what I wanted. What you want is obedience. Okay? So look at Titus 1:16. They profess that they know God, but in works they deny him, being abominable, disobedient, and unto every good work reprobate. And so all the good things that they're doing, even though they are good things, it's reprobate because of their motivations behind it, why they're doing it. I don't have time to go in the whole teaching that I do on repentance and the difference between true and false repentance, but it's very significant. Because a lot of people think that if they stop doing what they're doing, they've repented. But that's not necessarily the whole truth. A lot of people may, let's say they never go to church, and so now they start going to church. But if they're only going to church to sell Amway or meet a boyfriend or a girlfriend, that's not repenting. Okay? And the way I define repentance, there's three factors you have to have. Okay? The first thing that I believe happens, you have to change your mind. You have to agree, okay, what I've always thought was okay is really wrong. But if you don't stop, is that repentance just because you changed your mind? You have to stop. Okay? So besides a change of mind, though, you also have to have a change of heart, and you also have to have a change of behavior. So your mind is going to change and affect your heart that you don't want to do it, and then it's going to result in a change of behavior. A lot of people will change their behavior, but they haven't changed their mind. And a lot of people maybe have changed the heart, but they've never changed their behavior. So I believe you really need all three. You need to change your heart, you need to change your mind, you need to change your behavior, and that's going to be the result of true repentance. But let's take a look now at a crooked back. In Mark 4, 18 and 19, it talks about, these are they which are sown among thorns. These are the ones who hear the word and the cares of this world, the deceitfulness of riches, and the lust of other things enter in, they choke the word, and it becomes unfruitful. 1 Peter 5, 7, we're to cast all of our cares upon him, for he cares for you. In Mark 4, 18 and 19, here you see it's someone who's loading up all the cares. They're carrying this heavy burden, right? And so think of this hunchback from them trying to carry all of these heavy burdens. in Matthew 11, verse 28 and 30, what God says, he says, come unto me, all you that are that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I'm meek and lowly of heart, and you shall find rest unto your souls, for my yoke is easy, my burden is light. And so here we find from this verse that God says, or Yeshua is saying, come to me, all you that labor. But I tell you what, if you're going to yoke up with Yeshua to find rest, okay, what does that mean? What is the yoke that he's talking about? Okay? And do you notice, and here's another good example, how just about every verse in the New Testament is tied to the Old Testament. And that's why you have to look at them and compare. Right here, he says, all you that labor and are heavy laden, learn of me. He says, take my yoke upon you. He says, my yoke is what? It's easy, my burden is light. And he says that you're going to find rest for your souls when you do that. Look at Jeremiah 6, 16. Thus says the Lord, stand you in the ways and see and ask for the old paths, where is the good way, and I want you to walk therein, and you shall find rest for your souls. The way you find rest for your souls is going back to Torah, returning to the old ways. But what did they say? We don't want to walk that way. We don't want to walk in your ancient ways. We want to walk in our ways. The yoke in Judaism always referred to Torah. So when he says, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, he's saying, I'm all through the Torah. There's rest in Torah. Why do you think they called it the Sabbath rest? There's so much rest in Torah, and you cast all your cares upon him, you learn about him, you're going to find true rest. But problem is, people don't understand the Torah, and they get laden down by priests who don't understand the Torah, and they lay these burdens upon people. But there's a balance to all of this. And in Galatians 6:2, it says we're to bear one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ. How can we bear another's burden if we're hunchback and can't even bear our own? So as a priest, how can you minister if you're so burdened down with the cares of this world and all of these things? How can you minister to someone else? You need to get healed. You need to get the burdens taken off. You need to get rested up so then you can go help someone else. Does that make sense? Okay, let's look at the next one. The next priest that had a blemish was a dwarf. Okay, well, the definition in the dictionary of a dwarf is someone who is perfect in form and function, but they're below the standard. Well, what I think that is speaking of here, if you look at 1 Peter 2:2, it says, as newborn babes desire the sincere milk of the word that you may do what? Grow by. 2 Peter 3:18, it says, grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be glory both now and forever. Amen. So what I think this is talking about from a spiritual standpoint, people that are still immature babies, they have no spiritual growth. They're not growing in grace. They're spiritually stunted. I mean, there's a lot of people out there that they're spiritually immature. Look at 1 Corinthians 13:11. When I was a child, I spoke as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. When I became a man, I put away childish things. How many of you know that sometimes we need to put away childish things? Sometimes a lot of adults are just big little kids, and they've never spiritually matured. Something has happened in their life and that stunted their growth, and they need to get healed. Okay? But we have to put childish things. So when I look at that, what I see it as is someone who's not having any spiritual growth. Let's look at Ephesians 4, 14 through 15. It says that henceforth we be no more children tossed to and fro, carried about with every wind of doctrine, by the sleight of men, the cunning craftiness whereby they lie in wait to deceive. But we need to speak the truth in love that we may what? Grow up into him in all things, which is the head, even Christ. So the whole concept is we need to grow up. Now let's look at the next blemish. The next blemish is having a blemish in your eye. That's from Leviticus 21:20. Well, what is that talking about? If you have a blemish in your eye, you're going to have distorted vision. That's why in Matthew chapter 7, verse 2 through 5, it talks about, you know, hey, how are you going to say to your brother, let me pull out the mote out of your eye, and behold, a beam is in your own eye, you hypocrite. First cast out the beam of your own eye, and then you'll see clearly to cast out the mote of your brother's eye. I mean, can you imagine when you think of a big beam and you think of a little mote? If your brother or sister has a little mote and you got this big beam coming out of your eye, when you go to take the mote out of theirs, you're going to be clobbering them in the head with your beam. Okay? And so get that beam out, then you can see clearly. So this is talking about a priest or someone who wants to minister the gospel, but they have distorted vision. Look at Romans 2:1. Therefore, you are without excuse, O man, everyone who judges, for in that which you judge another, you condemn yourself, for you who judge are doing the very same thing. I can't help but think of our politicians nowadays. You know, they're supposed to be the senators, the one passing the laws, and how many of the, you know, all of our congressmen, senators, whatever, you know, even our judges. Judges are taking bribes and all these different things. But the one thing that, and there's a whole nother Hebrew mindset to judging that I don't even have time to get into, and when there are proper times. But the point that I want to bring in here is oftentimes the people that are hardest on a particular sin, that's typically they're doing the very same thing. And they're trying to mask it. That's how they try to come across, well, that person probably couldn't do that because look how hard they are on it. Typically, it's just the opposite. They're doing it. They're coming against it so strongly because it's that's how their way of hiding it, that it couldn't be them. But all too often, when we're pointing the finger at someone else, you're in trouble, especially if you're the one that's doing that. Now, think about this. In Proverbs 30:12, it says there's an entire generation, they're pure in their own eyes, yet they've not been washed from their filthiness. I can't help but think of the generation that we're living in almost now. A lot of people think they're totally pure in their own eyes, they are, but yet they're completely filthy. This reminds me of a whole another story that I want to tell as we're going here. To give you an idea of what I'm talking about, people always talk about looking at for a balance. Let's look at the middle, you know, so you don't get two extremes. But the problem comes is when the middle has moved. Now let me give you an example. How many of you remember the very first time there was a cuss word mentioned in the movies? Do you remember the name of the movie? Gone with the Wind. And when did that come out? Late 40s or something like that? Do you know exactly when? 1939 was the first time a cuss word, and it was damn. And do you know what? The public was shocked. That made the newspapers, that made the headlines around the world. The entire public was shocked that they used that word. 70 years later now, the church is below the standard of the world of 70 years ago. The church isn't even shocked by that word. And so think about where the world is today. At this rate, 70 years from now, the church is going to be below where the world is today. The center has moved. We really need to realize that. I mean, it's like Lot in Sodom and Gomorrah. He's become numb to it. The body of Messiah has become numb like Lot. And the reason why is we've come so used to it, it doesn't even shock us anymore. We see so many things in the games that they play, the kids play, so many things on television, we hear on the radio, we see on the billboards, we've come desensitized. We don't even know. We're like the frog in the boiling water. Do you know what Lot's name means? Remember Lot at Sodom and Gomorrah? Do you know what his name means in the picture land? Okay. You have the Lamed, which means authority. Remember he sat in the gate? Remember he sat in the gate? So he was to be like a judge or an authority? Do you know the people of Sodom and Gomorrah didn't mind him sitting in the gate as long as he didn't make any judgments? The minute he began to assert his authority, they said, who are you? Who made you a judge over us? So the public doesn't mind if the church is there as long as they don't tell them anything. Lot's name, the first letter is the shepherd's staff, which means authority. The next letter is the vav, which is the nail. The next letter is the tet, which is the serpent. So Lot is the one who's given his authority over to the serpent. It's just kind of interesting. Now, as far as the body, do we want to be like Lot or Abraham? Abraham was separate. He was doing the interceding. See, that's, he was in it, but not of it. Lot was in it and with it. There's a whole another story that is amazing. I don't have time to get into that because that's not my point. But that's a whole nother lesson on Sodom and Gomorrah and what was going on. Okay. Let's look at Isaiah 11:2-3. The Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, and shall make him of quick understanding in the fear of the Lord. He shall not judge after the sight of his eyes, neither reprove after the hearing of his ears. So here the Messiah, he has no blemishes in his eyes, but first off, he's not going to be judging by the sight of his eyes anyway. He's going to be looking at the heart. Okay? Now let's look at this next one. Scurvy. What is scurvy caused by? A lack of fruit in your life. Hello? Or is this making sense or what? It's a result of an improper diet. And that's why also the apostle says, I failed not to preach the whole gospel of God. If you're going to a congregation and all you hear about is getting saved every day or every week, you're not growing. You're having an improper diet. You need to go somewhere where you get the whole counsel of God, not just part of it. You following me? So that's another layer of this thing. Let me show you this one here. How many of you know about the four major food groups? You have grains and breads, fruits and vegetables, meats, milk and dairy. Well, do you know the Bible has all four of those food groups? Okay, it talks about as newborn babes. As newborn babes desire the sincere milk of the word that you may grow thereby. Here we have the milk of the word. All right? I fed you with milk, though, and not with meat, for hitherto you were not able to bear it, neither yet now are you able. So at the point, you also need, besides the milk, you need what? Meat. But it says, everyone that uses milk is unskillful in the word of righteousness, for he's still a baby, but strong meat belongs to them that are full age. So the Bible talks about the milk of the word. It talks about the meat of the word. And then if you look at John 6:35, the Lord says, I am the what? The bread of life. Here you have the milk, you have the meat, you have the bread. And you might be familiar with the fruit of the Spirit. So the Bible has your four major food groups. Okay, so that you can have a proper diet. Talks about the fruit of the Spirit. That's why in Acts 20, 27 and 28 is where Paul says, I have not shunned to declare unto you all the counsel of God. Take heed therefore to yourselves and to all the flock over which the Holy Ghost has made you overseers to feed the church of God of which he's made you, which he has purchased with his own blood. So remember the Lord said to Peter to do what? Feed my sheep. Okay, all through the Bible, that's what he wants us to do as ministers. If you're the priest, you're supposed to feed the sheep, but you have to feed him a proper diet. What happens if you only give your kids cookies and ice cream? Okay, you have to give a balanced diet as a minister. I'm just talking about if you feel like, because again, not everyone is called to be a minister per se or to reach out, but if you feel like that's your ministry, you got to make sure you have a balanced diet. Okay, now we have scabbed. What's interesting in Hebrew, this basically refers to skin diseases that primarily affect the scalp. Okay? Look at Psalm 68:21. But God shall wound the head of his enemies and the hairy scalp of such a one that what? He continues on in his trespasses. Okay, so a priest that continues on in the same trespass over and over and over again, God is going to wound the scalp. It's going to become scabbed. Now look at Isaiah chapter 3. It starts off saying in verse 15, what mean you that you beat my people to pieces? You grind the faces of the poor, says the Lord God of hosts. Moreover, the Lord says, because the daughters of Zion are what? Haughty. They walk with stretched forth necks, wanton eyes, walking and mincing as they go, making a tinkling with their feet. Therefore, the Lord says, I'm going to smite with a scab, the crown of the head of the daughters of Zion. So here we see getting a scab, it talks about. On the crown of your head is people who are walking in a haughty way. I know more than you. I'm better than you. In Ezekiel, look at chapter 16, verse 11 and 12. In Ezekiel 16, it says, I mentioned this the other day, God is speaking to Israel, and he says, I decked you also with ornaments. I put a bracelet upon your hand, and I put a chain upon, your neck. And I put a jewel on your forehead and earrings in your ears and a beautiful crown upon your head. So here the Lord, he decked Israel with ornaments. And you notice it says he put a chain around their neck. What do you think he's talking about? See, this, I was talking to Art earlier today, and one of the things we were talking about is to show you guys how to connect these dots so you can see these things. And here the Bible talks about how God took Israel and he put this beautiful chain around their neck. Do you know what the beautiful chain was that was around their neck? Well, let's look at what it says. In Proverbs 1, 8 and 9, my son, hear the instruction of your father, forsake not the Torah of your mother, for they shall be an ornament of grace unto your head. And what? The chain about Israel's neck was the Torah. And so when you want nothing to do with Torah, you throw it out, you're ripping off the gorgeous chains that God has placed around your neck and you're chucking it. Now, let me ask you this. How many of you are familiar? I mentioned Sodom and Gomorrah earlier. How many of you think you know what the sin of Sodom and Gomorrah was? Okay. Someone tell me what they think the sin of Sodom and Gomorrah was. Homosexuality. Well, you know what's fascinating? That you know what dandelions are growing? And my mom used to pay me a penny for every dandelion I'd pull out, you know, as a way to earn money. But half the times, I would just grab them and pull them, you know, pull off the head or something. What happens if you just attack the surface of it? So it keeps going, okay? The sin of Sodom, the homosexuality, was the surface. It wasn't the root. What was the root that brought it? Okay? Yeah, it's in Ezekiel. Let's take a look at your notes here. In Ezekiel 16, verse 48 and 50. As I live, says the Lord God, Sodom your sister has not done, she nor her daughters, as you have done, you and your daughters. Behold, this was the iniquity of your sister Sodom. Number one, pride. Number two, fullness of bread. Number three, an abundance of idleness. Fat and lazy, full of pride, was in her and in her daughters. Neither did she strengthen the hand of the poor and the needy. And they were what? Haughty. They committed abomination before me. And so I took them away as I saw good. And so what we really see here, and remember, in Proverbs 6, it says there's six things the Lord hates. Yea, seven are an abomination to him. And what is the very first one? Pride. A proud look. Okay? And then what? Okay, you have a lying tongue, you got a haughty spirit, you got hands that shed innocent blood. Here's the thing. All too often, this church picks and chooses not only what laws they want to obey, they pick and choose the sin based on public sentiment. Do you know homosexuality is not even in the top 10? If you go look at Proverbs, it mentions seven abominations. Homosexuality is not even there. But you know what is in there? Those that sow discord among the brethren. How often do we judge the homosexuality unequal measures, but we don't judge those among our midst that is even more abominable, that are sowing discord? How about a proud look? How many people in the church walk around with a proud look? That's more abominable to God than the homosexual. And yet we'll come so hard down, not realizing they just need to get healed too. Okay? But we'll pick and choose according to public sentiment which sins that we want to really come against and fight against. Man, we got to start in here and let's get rid of the pride look. How many lying tongues do you hear about in the church? Okay, so I'm just trying to find a balance here. Okay. So now let's look at the last one here. Is the last blemish was to have their stones broken. Okay, well, what in the world does that mean? All right? Well, what that means is if the priest, his testicles were damaged, okay? And so they couldn't have produced kids. Well, basically, it means your inability to reproduce. And God wants us to reproduce disciples. It's all about discipleship, okay? So if a priest isn't able to train up another priest, he's not able to, and God wants us to do what? He said, go make disciples. Look at this. In Galatians chapter 4, verse 18 and 19, what does a man say, the Apostle Paul? He says, it is good to be zealously affected, always in a good thing, and not only when I'm present with you, my little children, of whom I travail in birth until Christ be formed in you. So here this man saying, I'm travailing in birth until Christ be formed in you. So that's what this is talking about. We need to have the desire to make sure that we can teach others to the point that they can teach others, to the point that they can teach others, which is why Paul said in Timothy, I want you to teach others who can teach others also. Okay, so that's why I think this Wellspring ministry is so good. And what we need to do is we need to teach others to teach others. That's how you know you're being fruitful. I want to have a lot of spiritual grandkids and great-grandkids. And so that's why we have our notes available, our PowerPoints, you know, CDs, because I want you guys to teach this stuff. I'm not doing this for you. I'm doing this for your kids, for your grandkids. That's who I'm doing this for. Because that's why in John 15, God says, I don't want you to bear a little bit of fruit. I want you to bear much fruit. So we need to learn to share this stuff. That's what this Hebrew Roots is all about, is take this stuff and run with it. I want you guys, and you know, there's nothing more exciting than when you share this stuff with someone and their eyes just all of a sudden open up. It's like, oh my gosh. And then that gets you excited and you share more. But the thing that I've also found, other people just totally reject it, want nothing to do with it. So it's a real dichotomy. It's kind of strange. But the thing that I find, if they don't get it, I don't get upset. I move on. It just means they're not ready. So don't get discouraged. Just go. There's too many people out there that want this stuff. So in John 15, I mentioned how they must bear much fruit. In Colossians 1:10, he says he wants us to walk worthy, being fruitful in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God. In 2 Timothy 2:2, also is where he says, I want you to commit this to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. And so that's what he wants us to do. He wants us to, everything that we have heard, he says, of Paul, I want you to commit it to faithful men who can teach others also. So now we're done with the 12 blemishes. So now what are spots? Now we're going to take a look at spots and wrinkles. Here again in Ephesians 5, 26 and 27, he says he wants to present him a glorious church that doesn't even have any what? Okay, so what are spots? Do you know the Bible tells you what the spots are, just like it told you what the blemishes were? In Jude chapter 1, verse 11 and 12, it says, woe to them, for they have gone in the way of Cain. Okay. They ran greedily after the error of Balaam for reward. They perished in the gainsaying of Korah. These are spots. You ever seen that before? Right there. I mean, it tells you what the blemishes are. It tells you what the spots are. Well, let's look at Genesis. Let's go back in Genesis chapter 4. And let's look at verse 8 through 10 and then verse 12 and 13. Here we see it says, Cain rose up against Abel his brother, and he slew him. And the Lord said unto Cain, where is Abel your brother? Now, do you think God was wondering where he was, or was he really asking Cain a question and maybe giving him a chance to repent? And Cain said, oh, I don't know. Am I my brother's keeper? And God said, what have you done? The voice of your brother's blood cries out to me from the ground. A fugitive and a vagabond shall you be in the earth. And Cain said to the Lord, oh, my punishment is greater than I can bear. What a whiny, whiny, self-centered guy. He wasn't even concerned about his brother Abel, who he just killed. But now this is something that you see in the Hebrew, you don't see in the English, that to me is totally incredible. Here, when the Lord says, your brother's blood cries out to me from the ground, do you know in Hebrew the word blood is in the plural? It's not only Abel, but all of his offspring that will never be born. The word blood there is in the plural, not in the singular. It's not just Abel that's crying out from the ground. And Cain goes, oh, this is just too great that I'll be a fugitive and a vagabond. But let's look at this in 1 John 3, verse 11 and 12, that talks about this situation. It says, for this is the message that you heard from the beginning. And by the beginning, I think of the book of Genesis, in the beginning. It says that we should do what? Love one another, not as Cain, who was of the wicked one and slew his brother. Now here's the big question. Why did he kill him? Why? Well, it answers you. It says, because his own works were evil and his brothers were righteous. So here, what's amazing to me about the way of Cain, he was religious. He offered sacrifices. Do you realize the first murder was over religion? And not much has changed. What do we see in James 1:27? Pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this, to visit the fatherless and the widows in their affliction and to keep themselves what? Unspotted from the world. There it is. When you begin to look at spots, wrinkles, and blemishes, you're going to begin to find it all through the Bible. But that's what it is. It means to do something. Don't just sit there and say, be warmed and filled. Okay? Do what you can do and keep yourself unspotted from the world. The second thing is, he was envious. He was full of hatred, wrath, strife. He was a murderer. He was irreverent, and he was a liar. He said, I don't know. And the way he talked back to God, he was totally irreverent. So he was basically a man of the flesh. And why do I say that? Let's look at Galatians 5:19 through 21. These are the works of the flesh. Okay, adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft. But look at this. Hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, what? Envying, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like, of the which I tell you before, as I've told you in times past, they that which do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. Several of those things, that's what Cain did. He was jealous, he was envious, he was a murderer, full of wrath and hatred. And so what is the way of Cain? When he says he wants to present himself a church without spot, he's saying, don't go this route. Don't be full of envying and jealousy and hatred and murder. Don't be a man of the flesh. That's what Cain was. Well, what about the heir of Balaam? What was the heir of Balaam? Well, Balaam, he loved the wages of unrighteousness. What else? He was self-willed, and he was also disobedient. Look at 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 13 through 15. It says, spots they are and blemishes, sporting themselves with their own deceivings while they feast with you, having eyes full of adultery that cannot cease from sin, beguiling unstable souls, a heart that they've exercised with covetous practices, cursed children which have forsaken the right way, they've gone astray, they followed the way of Balaam, the son of Beor, who loved the wages of unrighteousness. So we see he was what? He was greedy. He was a very greedy person. Now look at this also. What else is the way of Balaam? In Numbers 22:6. Therefore I pray you, come now, Balak says, and curse this people for me, for they are too mighty for me. Perhaps I shall prevail so that we may strike them, and so that I may drive them out of the land. For I know that he whom you bless is blessed, and he whom you curse is cursed. Well, what does the Bible say about out of the same mouth proceeds blessings and cursings? That's what Balaam was. Out of the same mouth would come blessings and cursings. The other thing is, he was an evil counselor. Very important as we look at the way of Balaam. He was an evil counselor. Look at Numbers 31:16. It says, behold, these, referring to Balaam and Balak, the Moabites, caused the children of Israel through the counsel of Balaam to commit a trespass against the Lord in the matter of Peor, and there was a plague among the congregation of the Lord. What counsel did Balaam give? Well, I'll tell you in a minute here, but look at Revelation 2:14. It says, I have a few things against you, because you have there them that have hold the doctrine of Balaam. Well, this is an end time thing here now. So from an end time perspective, what was the counsel that Balaam was giving back then. We need to understand that. And what did he do? He taught Balak to cast a stumbling block before the children of Israel. Are there churches today that are throwing stumbling blocks before the children of Israel to eat things sacrificed to idols and to commit fornication? I think what's fascinating is what the Moabites didn't want is Israel to have the land. And so this whole talk of dividing the land of Israel, and that's going to become a big issue in these last days. And so we need to understand that through the counsel of Balaam. There are a lot of people that have the counsel of Balaam about dividing the land, and they're casting a stumbling block in front of the children of Israel. Not just that way, in a lot of ways. But we know from Joel 3, 1 and 2, it says, "Behold, in those days and at that time when I bring again the exiles of Judah and Jerusalem." Well, that's what happened. That's what's been happening in this generation. He says, "I will also gather all nations, bring them down to the valley of Jehoshaphat, and I will fight with them for my people, for my inheritance, Israel, whom they've scattered among the nations," and what? My land. Who's he going to come against? Those that are trying to divide his land, especially Jerusalem, because Jerusalem is the apple of his eye. You're poking God in the eye when you try to divide Jerusalem. So then lastly, we have the way of Korah. Now, what about Korah? Do you remember who Korah was? Anyone remember who Korah was? Okay, what tribe was Korah from? He was a Levite, okay? And what was Korah's rebellion? What did he want to do? Do you remember what Korah wanted to do? Okay, he wanted to be a priest. Well, no, wait a minute. Weren't the Levites priests? Well, then how come Korah, who's a Levite, wanted to be a priest? Well, here's the thing. Do you know 90% of the Levites were not priests? 90% of the Levites were not priests. Only the sons of Aaron were priests. Levi had three sons: Gershon, Merari, and Kohath. Kohath had four sons: Amram, Uziel, Izhar, and Hebron. Amram, if you remember, and Jochebed beget Moses and Aaron. Amram's brother Uziel beget Korah. Korah and Moses were first cousins. Their dads were brothers. How much closer can you get? But Korah was upset because he wanted the priesthood. He was a Levite, but he wasn't a priest. Only the sons of Aaron were priests. A lot of Christians misunderstand that. The vast majority of Levites were never priests. All they did was schlep the tabernacle around the wilderness. Okay? Korah wanted a bigger job than that. He wanted the glory. Now, they ended up becoming the singers. A lot of them were obviously, they're not schlepping a tabernacle around when there's a temple, like Solomon's temple. So the Levites, they still were not priests, but they were the singers. They were the choir. They would sing the songs. They would do different things in the temple, but they could not do any of the sacrifices. Only the sons of Aaron could. But what do we know about Korah? Korah was a conspirator. He was envious. He was jealous. He makes false accusations, things that were totally untrue. We see in Numbers 16, 1 through 3, and here's where I go through and show you how Korah was the son of Izhar, the son of Kohath, the son of Levi. So you can see exactly what I said. But I want you to go to the bottom where he says, "You take too much upon you, seeing all the congregation are holy, every single one of them, and the Lord is among them. Why then do you lift up yourself above the congregation of the Lord?" That's what Korah was saying. But realize, and you can see here from my chart, who Levi begot, and you can see that Moses and Kohath were first cousins, just like I was saying. Now in Numbers 6, look how God responds. He says, Moses says to Korah, "Hear now, I pray you, you sons of Levi. Does it seem a small thing to you that the God of Israel has separated you from the congregation of Israel to bring you near to himself to do the service of the tabernacle of the Lord? And to stand before the congregation to minister to them, and he's brought you near to him and all your brethren, the sons of Levi, with you, and you seek the priesthood also?" So I want you to notice most of the Levites were not priests. Okay? That's just something that just most people don't really realize. And so what did Korah do in his pride? Korah gathered all the congregation against them to the door of the tabernacle of the congregation, and the glory of the Lord appeared to all the congregation. And then we find in Numbers 16, verse 32 through 35, It says, and the earth opened her mouth and swallowed them up, and their household, and all the men who were for Korah, and all of their goods. They and all that they had went down alive into Sheol. The earth then closed up. How often do you see an earthquake that opens up and then turns around and closes back up? And it says that they perished from among the congregation, and all of Israel around them fled at their cry, for they said, lest the earth swallow us up. And then what happens? Okay, then it says there came out a fire from the Lord and burned up the 250 men that were offering incense. Wow! This giant fire comes and just burns them all up. So what happened to the sons of Korah? Did all the sons of Korah die? Who can tell me a son of Korah that became a very famous person? The prophet Samuel. The prophet Samuel was the son of Korah, and he obtained the priesthood. Go research it. Take a look. The prophet Samuel was one of the sons of Korah. And a matter of fact, a lot of the Psalms were sung by the sons of Korah. You go back and look in the Psalms. Yeah. So anyway, now the next question comes, how in the world do we get rid of spots and blemishes? Right? Does that make sense? How do we get rid of them? Well, how many of you know soap and water isn't going to work? Jeremiah 2, verse 23. Listen to what it says here. It says, for though you wash yourself with nitre and take you much soap, yet your iniquity is what? Marked before me, saith the Lord God. Though in Hebrew you have the word nitre and soap. What that literally means is even if you take acid or alkaline, you get a very high acid, it's going to eat you up. You get a very high alkaline, it's going to eat you up. And God is saying neither one of those are enough because your iniquity is marked. Well, in Hebrew, the word marked means to be carved or engrave, to inscribe indelibly. So in other words, God is saying your iniquity is like a huge carving that has just completely penetrated your being. So soap and water isn't going to work. So what is it going to take? All right, well, let's take a look at what the Bible says. In Proverbs 16:6, it says, by mercy and truth, iniquity is purged. And it's by the fear of the Lord that men depart from evil. Look at 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 24 through 26. It says, and the servant of the Lord must not strive, but be gentle unto all men. Apt to teach, patient, in meekness instructing those that oppose themselves. If God peradventure will give them repentance to the acknowledging of the truth, that they may recover themselves out of the snare of the devil who are taken captive by him and his will. So what does God want us to acknowledge? The truth. The truth about who we are, who he is, but all too often we don't want to acknowledge the truth. Look at Leviticus 26, verse 40 through 42. It says, if they shall confess their iniquity and the iniquity of their fathers. See, this is important. This is confession. This is repentance. I not only don't have to confess my own iniquities, I got to go back to my generations. I need to confess the iniquity of my fathers. With their trespass, which they trespass against me, he says, and that also that they have walked contrary to me. Often we don't, we'll think, okay, I sinned, but I didn't necessarily walk contrary to you. But then he says, and that also I have walked contrary to them and have brought them into the land of their enemies. Now look at this, and this is in the Torah, Leviticus. It says, if then their uncircumcised hearts be humbled, and they then accept the punishment of their iniquity, then will I remember my covenant with Jacob, my covenant with Isaac, and my covenant with Abraham. I'll remember it, and I'll remember the land. And again, what does it say here? Jeremiah 3:13. He just says, just acknowledge your iniquity. How often do you have kids that you knew they did something wrong, and you know they did something wrong, and you're just waiting for them to acknowledge it? I'm ready to forgive you. I saw it happen. But I just want you to acknowledge that you've done wrong, or a spouse, or whatever. Isn't that what you really want? Sometimes the sin may not even have been that big of a deal as far as you're concerned. Maybe they stole your M&Ms, okay, or whatever. All you want them is to acknowledge that they've done it. This reminds me of a story. It wasn't in the notes. It's called The Duck and the Devil. There's this two little brother and sister that got to go over to Grandma and Grandpa's house to play over the weekend, and Grandpa gave Johnny the slingshot that he could have. So Johnny got the slingshot. He's just a little kid, and he's got the little rocks in the slingshot, and boing, he's firing things and all kinds of stuff, and he's missing by a mile. I mean, he can't even hit nothing. All of a sudden, he sees Grandma's pet duck walking along. So he puts his rock in, and he goes to sling it, and bing, it's a bullseye. Hits the duck right in the head and kills the duck. Oh, no, now what am I going to do? And he goes, and he quick takes the duck, and he hides it under a wood pile, and he turns. There's his sister Sally watching the whole thing. Sally doesn't say a word. Sally just walks off. Later on that evening, Grandma says to Sally, "Sally, would you help me do the dishes?" And Sally goes, "Oh, I'd love to, Mommy, but Johnny, he really wants to do it, don't you, Johnny? Remember the duck?" Johnny goes, "Yeah, I want to do the dishes." And Johnny does the dishes. And the next day, Grandpa says, "Okay, I want to take everybody fishing. Johnny, do you want to go fishing?" And Sally goes, No. Yeah, well, first off, Grandma says, "Well, Sally needs to stay to help make dinner." And Sally goes, "Oh, no. I'm going to go fishing with Grandpa. Johnny said he wanted to stay and help make dinner. Remember the duck?" Johnny goes, "Yeah, I want to stay and help make dinner. Don't want to go fishing with Grandpa." So later on that evening, Johnny had had enough of Sally. And Johnny goes up to Grandma and says, "Grandma, I'm sorry that, you know, what really happened. I'm the one that killed your duck." And Grandma says, "Yeah, I know. I saw the whole thing happen all along. I was just wondering how long you were going to let Sally take advantage of you." How often do we let the devil beat us up and take advantage of us, not realizing God has seen the whole thing all along, and he's always ready to forgive us, and we just let the devil tromp all over us, and all we need to go to God and confess and repent? It's the devil and the duck. So we see in Leviticus 26:42, he goes on to say, if their uncircumcised heart be humbled, okay, so we just need to humble ourselves. Then in Jeremiah 3:13, he says, just acknowledge your iniquity that you've transgressed against the Lord your God. You've scattered your ways to the strangers under every green tree, and you have not obeyed my voice, says the Lord God. The problem is you've not obeyed my voice. How many of you know, have ever heard of the word Shema? You know what Shema means in Hebrew? The greatest commandment is what? To love the Lord your God. But it begins with Shema Yisrael, hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is one Lord, and you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart. The word Shema in Hebrew means to hear and obey. Okay, like you tell your kids to dump the trash several times, they go, "I heard you," and you say, "I don't want you to hear me, I want you to do it." Okay, well, in Hebrew it's one word, Shema. I want you to hear me, and I want you to do it. Well, there's a play in Hebrew you don't see in English, you only see it in Hebrew, but when Samuel didn't kill all the Amalekites like he was supposed to. Okay, Samuel confronts Saul, who didn't do it. And Saul says, "I did too obey." And Samuel says, "Well, if you obeyed, how come I hear the bleating of the sheep?" It means to hear and obey. So Saul did not hear and obey, or Samuel wouldn't be hearing the sheep that he was supposed to have killed. So it's a play on words. So we need to hear and obey. In Isaiah 4, verse 3 and 4, it says, "It'll come to pass that he that is left in Zion, he that remains in Jerusalem, shall be called holy, even everyone that's written among the living in Jerusalem, when the Lord will have washed away the filth of the daughters of Zion, and shall have purged the blood of Jerusalem from the midst thereof by the spirit of judgment and by the spirit of burning." And then in Malachi 3, verse 2 and 3, it says, "Who may abide the day of his coming? Who will stand when he appears? For he is like a refiner's fire and like fuller's soap. He will sit as a refiner and purifier of silver, and he shall purify the sons of Levi and purge them as gold and silver, that they may offer to the Lord an offering in righteousness." Okay, so remember in the New Testament, a good example. What happens to the wood, hay, and stubble? But what happens to the gold, silver, and precious stones? So the problem isn't the fire. The problem is, what are you made out of? That's what it comes down to. What are we building with? Now, even in the New Testament, those people are saved, it says, but they have nothing to show for it. Look at Revelation 1, 5 through 6. It says, "And from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness and the first begotten of the dead, the prince of the kings of the earth, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood. And he's made us kings and priests to God and his Father. To him be the glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen." So only the blood of Messiah is what's going to wash us from our sins and our iniquity. But what happens, he wants us to acknowledge it. He wants us to repent. He wants us to acknowledge even the sins of our fathers so that he can accomplish this. Okay, so lastly, it says that he wants to sanctify his body and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word, that he might present it to himself, a glorious church, not having spot, or what else? What in the world's a wrinkle? We've looked at spots, and spots being like the way of Cain and Balaam and Korah. We've looked at blemishes. What in the world do you think wrinkles are? Well, one of the things I think is quite interesting is in Job 16:8, he says, "You filled me with wrinkles, which is a witness against me. My leanness rising up in me bears witness to my face." So we see a tying of leanness and wrinkles. Okay, right here. He says, "You filled me with wrinkles." Well, right here says, "I give up. These wrinkles just won't iron out." And what are wrinkles? Wrinkles are a crease or a fold of the skin caused from either folding or shrinking. Okay? Now, to begin with, when we find out what wrinkles are, we need to look at the word fat. All right? Do you know in English it says fat, 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 but in Hebrew there's a dozen different words for fat. And they each have a different meaning. So we got to go, let's through and look at what the word fat can mean. The first one we're going to look at is Strong's number 1878. The Hebrew word is dashen, and it literally means to anoint. We see in Proverbs 28:25, "He that puts his trust in the Lord shall be made fat." So here, fat's a good thing. It means he whoever puts his trust in the Lord is going to be anointed. So the anointing comes from putting your trust in the Lord. In Proverbs 13:4, it says, "The soul of the diligent shall be made fat." Your soul will be anointed, okay, if you're diligent. Then we have another word that's translated in English as fat, but the Hebrew word is chaleb, and it means the richest or the choicest part. In Leviticus 3:16, it says, "All the fat is the Lord's." There it doesn't mean the word anoint. It means the best, the richest. Remember like the Feast of First Fruits. It says in Genesis 4:4, "And you shall eat the fat of the land." This is the Hebrew word. You shall eat the best. In Genesis 4:4, it says, "And Abel, he also brought of the firstlings of his flock and of what?" That was the difference between Cain and Abel's offering. You want to know why Abel's was accepted and Cain's wasn't? Cain brought the best, or Abel, I mean, brought of the fat. Abel brought the best, the first fruits. Cain didn't. Some people think it was because Cain was from the ground, but that's not necessarily true, because in the offerings, you could bring grain offerings all the time. There was nothing wrong with bringing a grain offering. The problem was it wasn't the best. It was like the blind, the lame. He was just giving God the garbage, the leftovers. That's why it wasn't accepted. And this will tell you Abel's was accepted because he gave of the first fruits, the firstlings, the fat, the best. That's what the difference was between the two. So here the word fat is also good. But let's look at the next word for fat. It's tafash. And it means to be thick-headed, to be stupid, doing dumb things like in this picture. Someone overloads their car. Now let's look at Psalms 119, verse 70 through 72. Their heart is as fat as grease. So here, it's talking about their heart being dumb, thick-headed, and stupid. It's not the other kind of fats. But he says, "I delight in your Torah." So you delight in Torah, you're going to be pretty smart and wise. You won't be thick-headed and dumb. He says, "It's good for me that I've been afflicted, that I might learn your statutes. The law of the Torah of your mouth is better to me than thousands of gold and silver." Here the psalmist says the Torah is better than thousands and thousands of dollars of gold and silver. And yet how many of us would take gold and silver over the Torah any day? Because we don't understand the value of things. Then there's another fat. It's the word shaman, and it means to shine, to be oily or gross. We see that in Deuteronomy 32, verse 13 through 15. It says, concerning Israel, he made him to ride high on the high places of the earth so that he might eat the increase of the fields. He made him to suck honey out of the rock, oil out of the flinty rock, butter from cows, milk from the sheep. But now watch here. It keeps saying fat, but sometimes there's different words for fat. This is why when you read a text, you really need to go back because you don't know what you don't know, and it's saying different things. Here it says, you're going to, with the fat of the lambs, or the best of the lambs, and rams of the sons of Bashan, and goats, with the fat of kidneys and wheat, or the best. And then it says, you drank the blood of the grapes, but then Yeshurun grew fat. And here it means oily or gross. You grew fat, oily and gross, thick and satisfied. Then he forsook God who made him, and he lightly esteemed the rock of his salvation. And so here we see people that God had given them the best of everything. And they had the best, they partook on it, and then like Sodom and Gomorrah, they got fat and lazy, and they weren't doing anything. And so what happens when do you seek God when you're poor or when you're rich? It's usually the people that think they have need of nothing are the ones that forget God. Why do you think in Revelation it says, because you say I am rich and I'm increased with goods and I have need of nothing, and you don't know you're wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked. So here you have the Laodicean church that thinks they're rich, but really, and they think they have need of nothing. This verse ties right back to this verse where they lightly esteem the God of their salvation. And he's standing on the door knocking to the Laodicean church. They go, we don't even need you. You wouldn't even know you're gone. So we have to be careful with our life that we don't get consumed with riches and materialism, because then we don't realize we're blind, we're naked, we've got spots, we've got blemishes, and we're going to get wrinkles. In Luke 18:8, it says, nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on earth? That's a big question. In Deuteronomy 32:18 through 20, what do we see? It says, you forgot the rock who brought you forth. You ceased to care for God who formed you. And the Lord saw and despised them because of the provoking of his enemies. The provoking of his sons and his daughters. And he said, I'm going to hide my face from them. I'm going to see what their end will be. For they are a very perverse generation, sons in whom is no faithfulness. And if you remember, that same generation that wandered in the wilderness for 40 years... Then all of a sudden, in the Lord's time, you got a generation for 40 years, and then judgment came. And they were talked about as a generation of no faith. And now here in Luke 18, it's talking about his second coming, the times that we're living in. And he's wondering, is that same generation going to repeat the pattern and be a generation of no faith? That's the question. Remember, in the Bible, it's always the pattern. And so here we see Moses' generation. And think about this. They were about to enter the promised land. It was the generation that saw all the signs, that saw all the wonders, that saw all the miracles, the one that was going to inherit the promises. They were the generation that had no faith. Look at Psalms 78, verse 40 through 42. Now this is concerning his children. It's not concerning the unsaved. God's biggest problem is with his own kids, just like with you. Do you have a problem with the neighbor's kids or your kids? Your problems are with your kids. Sometimes it's with the neighbor kids, but mostly it's your kids. It says, how often did they provoke him in the wilderness? They grieved him in the desert. Yea, they turned back and tempted God, and they limited the Holy One of Israel. They remembered not his hand, nor the day when he delivered them from the enemy. Do you know what the word limit here means, where it says they limited the Holy One of Israel? I mean, can you limit God? What they did in the Hebrew, it means, remember in Deuteronomy, God says, I want you to obliterate all the idols of all the gods of the land, tear down, and I want you to erase their name so they're not even mentioned. The word limit here means to scratch out. So they were scratching out God's name. Where it says they limited the Holy One of Israel, it means they were trying to erase God's name. They didn't want to remember God. That's what they were doing. They're trying to scratch out his name. Let's look at another word for fat in Hebrew. 49:24, it's mashman, and it means a rich dish, a fertile field, a robust man. Now look at what we see in Isaiah 17:4. And in that day it'll come to pass that the glory of Jacob shall be made thin, and the fatness of his flesh shall do what? Wax lean. Think about this. Remember Job is full of wrinkles, and the leanness of his soul rose up and spoke against him? You're seeing a connection here between there was a fat, fertile field, a robust man, but it comes to pass that the glory of Jacob was made thin and the fatness of his flesh waxed lean. If you have someone that's very heavy set and then they lose a lot of weight, that's where the wrinkles come from, right? Okay, well, if you look at Isaiah 17:10, God says, because you've forgotten the God of your salvation and you've not been mindful of the rock of your strength. The problem is people have forgotten God. And so look at Psalms 106:10-12. It says, he saved them from the hand of him that hated them. He redeemed them from the hand of the enemy. And the waters covered their enemies. There was not one of them left. Then believed they his words and they sang his praise. And so when they saw the enemy was taken care of, then they were all rejoicing. Woohoo! Everything's great. Yay, God! But then what happened? They soon forgot his works. They waited not for his counsel. They lusted exceedingly in the wilderness. They tempted God in the desert, and he gave them their requests, but he sent what? Leanness to their souls. If that's what you want, I'll give you what you want, but you're going to have leanness sent to their soul, to your soul. Look at Amos 8:11-12. Behold, the days come, saith the Lord God, that I'm going to send a famine in the land. It's not going to be a famine of bread nor a thirst for water, but of what? Hearing the words of the Lord. Now, I want you to know that, note this. It doesn't say there's going to be a famine of the word of the Lord. There's going to be a famine of hearing the word of the Lord. In other words, there's going to be thousands of churches all over, but they're not preaching the word of the Lord. You're going to have to search high and low to find a congregation that's really teaching the word of the Lord. That's what it's saying. They're going to abound and they're going to be there. And it says they're going to wander from sea to sea, from north even to the east, and they're going to run to and fro, and they're going to seek the word of the Lord. And what does it say? They're not going to find it, especially if you don't know where to go. In Psalm 103, verse 17-21, it says, the mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting upon them that fear him, his righteousness to his children's children, to such as what? Keep his covenant, to those that remember his commandments to do them. Let me ask you something. How, if your father or your mother ask you to do something, how do you honor them? Okay. So if God gives us commandments and we don't do them or remember them, are we honoring him? Well, it's the same thing. If you ask your kids to do something, they forget. Does that kind of show you dishonor? Well, we're to honor our father and mother because we're to honor God. And so it's to those who remember his commandments to do them, not just be proud of the fact I know them. It's not who knows the commandments, it's who does the commandments. It says, the Lord has prepared his throne in the heavens and his kingdom rules over all. Bless the Lord, you his angels that excel in strength, that what? Oh, wow, even the angels. Hearkening to the voice of his word, bless you the Lord, all you his hosts, you ministers that do his pleasure. Okay, let's look at 1 John. This is a New Testament verse. Whatsoever we ask, we receive of him because we keep his commandments and do those things that are pleasing in his sight. Let's look at Daniel 9:4. I prayed to the Lord my God and made my confession. I said, O Lord, the great, dreadful God, keeping the covenant and mercy to them that love him and to them that... How do we show we love him? If we... Why do you think it says in John 15:10, if you keep my commandments, you shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. Do you see how these tie together? Is there anything new? Look at 1 John 5:3. This is the love of God, that we keep his commandments. And his commandments, are they grievous and burdensome, tortuous, heavy yoke? This isn't on your notes, but what? Remember, guys, remember Micah 6:6-8? He has shown thee, O man, what is good. What does the Lord require of you but to do justly, to love mercy, and what's the last one? I want you to listen to those words. It doesn't say, I want you to be humble in front of me. It says, I want you to walk humbly with me because I'm a humble God. To have a proud man standing next to a humble God, pretty embarrassing. We have a humble God. Jeremiah 2:32, can a maid forget her ornaments or a bride her attire? Yet my people have forgotten me days without number. What upsets God is not that the unbelievers have forgotten him. He's upset because his own people have forgotten him. Remember Ezekiel 16:11, the chain upon your neck is what? His word, his commandments. We see that from Ezekiel 16:11, the same thing. So what do we find here? Quince of getting fat on all the blessings of the Lord and then forgetting and forsaking him. Therefore, he sends leanness to your soul.